Hello and welcome to Chester. My name is Nick Fry and I portray the Emperor Domitian in our Roman reenactments here in the city of Chester. Now behind me, you can actually see the Roman walls, and these encircle the entire city. We're the only city in the UK that still has its full circuit of walls, and you can walk around them and enjoy the views of the city and the surrounding countryside. But, as I say, they're Roman, and this weekend, 4th and 5th of June, we celebrate Chester's Roman heritage in the Roman Weekend. Now, this is the opening event of the MBNA Chesterval, and this is a series of events that takes place over the next few weeks throughout the summer, celebrating different aspects of the city's heritage. But, of course, I would say, wouldn't I, that the most important is the Roman. And this weekend, I'll be marching through the city at the head of my legionaries. We think it's one of the largest Roman events in the UK, and there'll be hundreds of soldiers marching through the city. I'll be at their head. I'm told we're even going to have a chariot and Roman cavalry, which should be very exciting. And then, after I've marched through the city, we'll be having gladiator matches in the amphitheatre. There'll be traders that you can talk to, that you can buy things from, soldiers you can talk to, find out about their armour. There'll be displays, military fighting, all sorts of things. Really, everything you ever wanted to know about Rome, but didn't perhaps dare to ask, or didn't know where to ask. Well, the answer to that question is Chester. The Roman festival, 4th, 5th of June.
You are welcome in Chester. You're here to protect us. You all seem a very, very able-bodied in body, voice, and your uniforms are a credit to your battalion?
Legion.
I'm very sorry, very sorry. Can I thank you all for mustering this weekend? It's a wonderful event, and I'm sure it'll go on from year to year, growing in your number, and we will sleep safely in our beds knowing you are here to protect us. Thank you.
Citizens of Diwa, soldiers of Rome, we are gathered here today to celebrate the city's heritage. This is the Roman Weekend, the opening event of the MBNA Chesterval series, a series of events running over the next few weeks in celebration of this city, its heritage, and its life and people. But today, we look back. We look back to the power that was Rome, the power that founded this fortress. And in honor of that, I, your emperor, am here today. Ego sum! Ego sum! Imperator Domitianus Germanicus Augustus Caesar, or in your barbarian tongue, the Emperor Domitian. I am come today to this outpost of my empire to do you honor and remember the honor that is bestowed upon you. For I am Domine et Deus, Lord and God. I am a living God. Come to do you and this place and this festival the largest gathering of Roman soldiers in this province. But remember who and what I am. I am the sword that sings in the dark. I am the sound of a legion marching to war. I am the axe that thuds into your skull. I am the law of Rome, Pax Romana. I am accuser, judge, and executioner. I am a living god, a son of Jupiter. I am Imperator. I am Domitian. I am Caesar. I am the glory that is Rome!
Hey! 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 H Right, what I'm doing here, I'm preparing the soldiers' lunch. We're having chicken stew, which is quite a favourite dish of theirs. I'm just chopping the veg, get the fire going, and then I can cook the chicken off, and I'll have that for their lunch. What we represent here is what was called a Pina, which was a fast food restaurant. In Rome, you weren't allowed to have cookers in your apartments, so you ate out. And that's what we are, fast food.
I don't know, but we have to get one right here.
Czech Republic. And this one here is our totem pole. So as you can see, in the middle of it, there is a little sign of our group. It's co-host Quinta Pretoria, yeah. And a little bit, and I don't know what to say more about it. Co ještě o tom? Co ještě o tom mám říct? Co? To jak chceš říct císař, vole? Caesars? Emperors, ne?
My name is Emily and I am with the Leg 2, the Roman group, and I am here to tell you a bit about games. Now, this particular game is called Merrill's. You have to have three counters each, and it's a little bit like noughts and crosses. You have to make three in a row going through the middle, but you can't make it round the edge. First of all, you have to place the counters on one by one in turn. Once you have done that, you're allowed to move the counters, but you're not allowed to jump over someone. So if I were to do this, my move would be to either move out the middle, move this way or this way. And I would have to make three in a row. But because this person made the wrong move, I can move here and make three in a row. They would have dolls, such, and this is a homemade one. We would make little clothes out of cloth, and the main doll is made out of clay. It is tied together with some string. We would sometimes wrap rabbit skins round our feet to act as socks. And we would have special shoes, like this one. This one is a sort of flip-flop. It doesn't have its proper sole on yet. This one we call a caligae, a carpetina. This one we call a carpetina. We would have to tighten it up or loosen it using the strings. And it's made of leather.
You heat the iron until it's red orange, and most blacksmithing is done on the profile of the anvil. So as I'm making a small knife, I need to draw out a tang. And I do this on the edge. So that I get that sort of shape, which will become the handle. The fuel we use is charcoal. Traditionally, blacksmiths used to use hornbeam, a semi-hardwood, which they favoured and they thought was the best. If I then take a second profile in exactly the same place, I'm starting to draw out my small knife. Knives like this have been found as far back as 500 BC. And they're very similar to knives in the kitchen today.
Colin. Okay.
This would be the finished item, and it would then have a small handle fitted to it, and that would be used just for preparing food, chopping up vegetables, cutting meat, much the same as they are today, once the handle is fitted.
I can't understand a word. Us Romans, we have two words for it. Barbaranus is one. Barbaranus basically means that when they speak, they sound like sheep. They meh all the time. Another one is Britannicule, which means little Britain. So, as I can't understand a word, I've no idea what they're talking about, but I'm just wishing I actually hadn't stood downwind of it because the smell is already really bad. I want to introduce you to the presenter for the culture display, Red Arm.
Ah! see an old slashing sword. This sword is designed to cut off hands, arms, and legs.
Take your head!
This freestyle of fighting,
make it most effective,
some part of the 10,000 years of British culture.
It's from before the Romans arrived. I can still move!
I'll take you a piece of time if I have to.
You're gonna have to!
Game's over now! I told him never to do that!
And achieve the finishing off the opposing champion. Now that is Andrew Sanders face off. It's very rare the champions would not fight. It's very rare. Now they are a bit of a fighting force. You see some of the warriors.
We want to kill Romans!
The room will blue comes slowly. Arguably, you are moved to class. The interesting thing. Ladies and gentlemen, you are the ancestors.
I will accept some of your terms. You are a chieftain, therefore we will accept you as a client king of Rome. But in order to act as a bond for your word, we will take 5 of your men, break your word, and they will. Die!
Five volunteers!
I'm not scared of these people!
You should be, barbarian!
Come on! Not join them!
You can bash your shield at me all you want, but look behind!
So what happened here is the enemy and the chief infantry. But looking at the enemy in the eye, walking slowly backwards.
See you in flash
off, there's no fear. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to give a big round of applause for all the Britons today.
Okay, over on the far side, you might notice the solar dress slightly differently. Little bit of every move here has to be done correctly, because if one goes against the wrong, then the whole region will fail. Every person has it. They were considered generally by the Roman army to be expendable.
Let's go!
Yeah.
So let us have three more big round of applause to the order.
Which was almost a trademark of the early legionary. They're still wearing ring mail shirts in some places, and this is a ring mail waist we learnt from the 1st century BC, right the way up to the 1100s. It was often referred to by the Romans as Gallic. They actually think it was probably the Romans being very eclectic people. They were probably just inheriting what's been stolen from the Romans. An excellent innovation. If you look at the early leaders here, they're mostly wearing the classic Roman army helmets. These legionaries, later legionaries, are around the late 3rd, early 4th century AD. These men are suit tunics, tick-style tunics. And these were originally from slightly curved, over-curved shields. And the unit closest to me being represented on the 2nd.
Well, we're here at the Roman Festival in Chester, and a good crowd has turned out today, and I've just come up to these two good people here. Can you tell me your name, please, sir?
David Lemmy.
And where are you from, David?
Cheltenham.
Oh, well, my daughter lives at Leckhampton, so you must know. And our camera lady there comes from Gloucester. Now, what brought you to Chester today, this particular event?
Visiting our children and grandchildren.
So what do you think of this event so far?
Absolutely brilliant. Very impressed with the professionalism of the Roman soldiers, and it's been a good day.
And obviously you've been to Chester quite often before this. Do you attend many of the events? Because Chester's got a full programme from now on.
It's the first event we've attended, but if we're here in the future, this could bring us back.
Well, you have quite a few events in Chester, don't you? In the Cheltenham, I should say, the Cheltenham Festival and things like that. Do you attend that much?
Not so much. We don't have anything like this in Cheltenham. There tend to be the Literature Festival, the Music Festival, and that's the Jazz Festival. Yeah. So rather different events to this, not an outdoor festival such as this.
But do you think this has been a successful day?
Absolutely brilliant. Absolutely.
Thanks very
brilliant.
Much, anyway. Thank you. Good. Well, I've now moved a little bit further along the queue, and I've come to a family. Now, what is your name, sir?
My name is Marcelo. It's a Spanish name.
So you've come. You're on holiday here from Spain,
well,
are you?
We live here. Yeah, have been living here for 6 years now. Yeah.
And what do you think of this event today?
I think it's fantastic. I mean, we enjoyed it absolutely a lot. Yeah, I think it's a total success. Yeah.
Now, Spain's got a reputation, hasn't it, for very good events and galas and things. How does this compare?
Well, we've just been once to Spain, but I mean, we're coming actually from Argentina originally. So this is. I mean, the level of organization is fantastic. I've seen something like this.
Now, Chester is renowned for its events, and as you've heard on the intercom, mm-hmm. there's going to be a lot more events. How many of these events do you think that you will follow?
Well, after this experience, I think I will continue to come to these events, as long as they are so good as this,
And do you think it's been well organized?
I think, very well. I mean, the kids enjoyed it absolutely. Food, different type of spectacles,
Well, thank you very much. And in Spanish, can you tell me what you think about it? Was it good?
You tell me.
Era muy bueno.
Muy bueno.
Thank you very much indeed. Cut.
Lovely.
You ready? Okay, rolling. Well, I've now come a bit further along the line, and I've come to two young people who are visiting this festival, Katie and Amy. Tell me, where are you from?
Leicester.
And what do you think, as young people, to this Roman extravaganza? Did you find it good?
Yeah, it was really interesting.
And do you come to Chester often to see events like this, or to go to the clubs, or use Chester as a meeting place?
We'd come to Chester to events like this and to come shopping and stuff.
And what do you think of it so far today? Have you been around the village and seen all what how the Romans used to live?
We've seen some of it, but not much.
And what do you think of the events that are coming on? They've announced them over the system here. Are there any that you will attend and come to? Such as the film shows. What about the film shows?
Yeah, maybe. It seems like it might be quite good.
Well, thank you very much for talking to us, and good luck.
Thank you.
ladies. Work the crowd, get in the line.
In the background.
Oh, he's going home now. Health and safety, you can't do that. Come on, Achilles, we're over here. Come on, one of the stewards actually sort of direct him over here. The Emperor here, we need to get this rabble to take the oath, the gladiator's oath. And here we have Acratius Kittus, the organizer of all the event this weekend, and he's going to come across and lead the gladiators in an oath to the Emperor.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know about you, but the heavens are lost. Simple style. He's going to try and tire three banners out.
So you can see here the difference between the two. One heavily armoured, but very rigid and has a problem with weight. The other, you're across his spear and it's going to hit over there. You've got a spear, one by the armour, which means he can move around faster. He's dropped his shield. I guess he's gone down as well. However, he's not out of it.
Tactics!
Thank you.
Yeah. getting here.
Thank you.
So ladies and gentlemen, please give a big round of applause for our standards. Each one representing
Can you clear, please?
The different legions that have come here to Chester today for this fantastic Roman festival.
I've got an equity card.
What's that?
You need it.
That one's so okay.
Are you feeling any better? You are. Okay.
What about you? Surprised you about the other day. I said to you, mate, I met him, I said, I'll come on.
partakes in sacrifice. This is something that women do not generally carry out. Some interesting facts about the Priest of Jupiter are that the elaborate code of regulations protected his form from ritual defilement. He was not chains that were worn by slaves and prisoners, nor could he look upon the army or people at work to touch a horse or anything unclean. Neither, he was also not permitted to absent himself from Rome overnight. That shape her body and sway of the hips. It has splits of the sides to show ankle for freedom of movement. This style of costume could be used for religious purposes and festivals. But equally, with long splits and ribbons for decoration and a much finer linen, maybe even a diaphanous robe, she would have been equally at home in, let's say, a formal setting. On her feet, she is wearing a lovely pair of sandals, which are the latest fashion from Pompeii. Volusia must be in demand as a dancer, as many of her less popular counterparts would have gone barefooted. In keeping with a lot of the images of dancers on mosaics and frescoes, Volusia has a veil over her left shoulder, which would flow around as she dances. In her hands, she has castanets, or catolia, as they are called in Latin. These are little finger symbols. To finish off her outfit, she wears a garland of flowers around her head. Dancers in the ancient world would cover the whole spectrum of society, from the very low to the respectable dancer, who would be employed by the households of the highest, to entertain their dinner guests. We even have records of a contract for a dancer called Isadora to attend a festival for so many days at the house of Crotalesia. The contract is the same as a modern contract in that it states payment and general terms of conditions. To sum up, using the words of Marcus Virilius Martelli, one of the best poets from the early Roman Empire, who wrote, "The famous dancers from Cadiz, modern Cadiz. Tireless in the lustful move, in gentle tremor, eager limbs. A Roman dancer." Next we have the Syrian dancer from the Arabian area. Assyria was on the Silk Road trade route from the Far East in China, and she wears a highly decorated tunic with embroidered sleeves. Over the top is a Pompeii-style tunic, because they like to keep up with the Roman fashions as well as making their own identity. You've noticed she has a sword on her head, and this is because the Bedouins, the nomadic people that had a lovely Astoria, custom where the women would demonstrate how well the swords were made by balancing them on their head or even dancing a little dance. She's still learning, so I think a round of applause might go obviously that sword's not well balanced.
Picatius, who's this man that keeps loitering for more?
I am here to buy slaves, and ideal in slaves. And these are not so bad at the moment, but we need to see more.
More slaves?
Yeah, you can't get enough. Costume of the Roman matron, a respectable married woman. She's wearing a white pallor. Her mantle for going out, which covers her up. Underneath, she is wearing a pink stola. The garment only a married woman wears. dyed with rose madden and pinned together with brooches. Underneath this, she is wearing a gap sleeve tunic. Both garments are belted. She is sporting a fashionable hairdo created with several hair pieces secured with decorative hairpins. She is also wearing the ultimate in goddess style makeup, for all of which she would need the help of the Lady Aurelia shows us what a high status Roman matron would have worn. Her outer garment, the stola, and the tunic beneath are both made of silk imported from China. At a glance, therefore, Aurelia's status and wealth are immediately obvious to a society where social standing was paramount. However, writers of our period did not concern about the amount of money being spent on such luxuries. For example, if I may quote Pliny the Elder, by my lowest reckoning, India, China and the Arabian Peninsula take from our empire 100 million sesterces every year. This is the sum of which luxuries our women cost us. I suspect he was being a bit typical penny-pinching man. Aurelia's shoes are modelled on those attributed to an unnamed empress, with, as you can see, perhaps pearls sewn into the uppers. We know that women took a great deal of interest in the clothes, hairstyles and makeup of the imperial ladies. For examples, contemporary statues of the empresses have balanced hair pieces so that they could always be seen sporting the latest styles. Aurelia's makeup also reflects the fashion of the time, where women contrive of makeup. Her beauty is all perfume or hair. Next along we have our 4th century lady. Her name is also Aurelia. And we have just jumped forward about 400 years. At this time the tunic is improved by the sleeves being cut onto the slant, losing the square effect of the earlier periods. The under tunic, which at this time has long, tight sleeves to the waist, sometimes seen with a band of embroidery. The pallor has undergone a major change, and instead of it covering the lady's whole body from head to foot, it now was wrapped around the body. The head was by a thin veil. The hair is worn in a plait wrapped around the crown of the head. A large ornamental pin is used in to hold the veil and hairstyle in place. Okay, last but not least, we have the widow of Rome. And straight away you can see that while she's a widow all in black, the Romans thought that wearing dark colours would hide them from the dead so that they could not so that they couldn't be haunted by the dead. When in public, the widow would always wear a veil, and she would have to remarry after 9 months, a normal year, unless he had performed her duty and had 3 children.
Their first set today. Thank you.